Welcome, wrestling fans. I'm Les Thatcher, and thanks for joining us in the Knoxville Civic Coliseum, where tonight Smoky Mountain Wrestling presents its first annual Volunteer Slam, and there will be crowned for the first time a heavyweight Smoky Mountain Wrestling champion. A lot of great fans, a lot of great wrestling stars, and I'm joined by my favorite co-host and longtime buddy, Phil Rainey. Phil, good to have you.
Thank you, Les. We have been watching the proceedings in this tournament for the last several weeks now. A lot of anticipation as we start the first round of this tournament. A lot of great wrestling talent. We're set for a great night of wrestling here in Knoxville, Tennessee.
Yes, we certainly are. And, of course, not only are we going to be seeing these wrestlers in action, we're going to be interviewing some of them. And in back in the both dressing rooms will be Dutch Mantel and Mark Aston, and they'll be talking to many of the top flight Smoky Mountain wrestlers. So, Phil, it's going to be a great night, and right now I think we should throw it to Dutch Mantel and Mark Aston back in the dressing room where they'll be interviewing some of the contestants in this Smoky Mountain tournament.
So let's get ready for the action.
Hello, everybody. I'm Dutch Mantel. I'm going to be in the locker room all through the tournament talking to guys like Paul Orndorff, Buddy Landell, and some favorites that I think are going to win the tournament. Whose favorites? My favorites.
Hello, wrestling fans. This is Mark Aston with Smoky Mountain Wrestling. I'll be in the dressing room tonight interviewing some of the winners and some of the losers in tonight's Volunteer Slam.
First tournament match, and we're here in the Knoxville Civic Coliseum. Tonight they will crown the very first ever Smoky Mountain Heavyweight Wrestling Champion.
You know, Les, we couldn't pick a better way to start a championship, a tournament, than to have the Dirty White Boy and Dixie Dynamite, and then Ron White. We go back a long ways when you talk about Ron
yes,
White, his antics.
Yes, we do. I wrestled against the Wright brothers back in the 60s and up into the 70s. And the Dirty White Boy is a very devious, tough customer to start with, Phil. But with encouragement and help and pointers from Ron Wright, it's going to make him doubly tough.
You know, for the last several weeks on Smoky Mountain Championship Wrestling, Wright has been pleading for money for a hip operation. And, you know, the commissioner has put a stop to that. He's not getting any sympathy from anybody.
Well, I'm sure the Dirty White Boy is listening to things Ron Wright says. But Phil, my experience is this. If Ron Wright tells me it's raining, I'm going to look outside before I'm sure one way or the other.
And let's see what Dixie can do to get out of the fans are chanting. Go, Dixie, go. A little short jab into the ribs. Shoots him off. Over the top. Good move. And again, over the top. Hip lock. And a beautifully placed drop kick sends the white boy scurrying for the hills.
Great moves by Dixie Dynamite.
Many world's heavyweight champion titles have been defended in this Coliseum. Right now, a test of strength. And of course, here's where Dixie's going to give up the edge, because the dirty white boy certainly has the size and ultimately the strength to overcome anything they may do here.
This might be a case right here, Les, where speed takes over against the weight of the dirty white boy. Look at that.
Nice reversal by Dixie Dynamite.
And you know, Dixie is a great fan favorite and ultimately with the children, though.
Yeah, I know. He was on our Channel 43 Fox Kids Club. Kids wrote in letters. They really liked him. He's a very personable young guy.
Power elbow once again. Headlock now by Dixie. Cranks down on the side headlock. And the white boy picks him to try and shake him loose. Dixie hangs on. Takedown. Nice move, and he's still in control.
You know, Les, we were talking before we started this television show how nervous that we would both be getting back into the swing of things. In about 5 minutes, we act like we've been doing it for how many years?
I don't want to say.
You've fallen right back into the groove.
You know, went through a lot of wrestling matches the same way. You got to get a little nervous before you step in that ring. And, you know, every man in this tournament tonight has got to be feeling a little bit of that jittery feeling back in that dressing room, because there's no tomorrow. It's one loss and you're out of there.
Right, and the guy who eventually winds up with the belt is going to be the man to respect here in the Smoky Mountain area.
Absolutely.
And of course, the fans over in Hickory, North Carolina, Lenora, North Carolina, up in Virginia, all across East Tennessee, down in Chattanooga, you're seeing some great matches right now on your television set. And when Smoky Mountain Wrestling comes to your area, you want to make sure to buy a ticket and go out and see them in person.
Absolutely. And of course, we've got coming up Nature Boy Buddy Landell. He'll be squaring off with Prime Time Brian Lee in another tournament match. And then we've got Timmy Horner, White Lightning, squaring off with Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff. So you see the caliber of talent that's in this tournament. So it's not something you can say, okay, we've picked the winner. Because the winner is going to come down to a matter of seconds and moves and counter moves.
Prime Time Brian Lee is not one of the favorites of Jim Cornette. We'll have to see what transpires as this tournament moves along.
Right now, the dirty white boy up in that ring taking over the offense in this contest. He has slowed the masked man down. Again, it appears that he's driving the fists or the points of the fingers into the throat, taking the wind. And of course, in any athletic endeavor, you lose the wind. It's all important, Phil. If you've lost that, you've lost everything.
Kick to the back by the dirty white boy.
10 minutes expired.
Body slam. And right now, the white boy is in the driver's seat, dropping the leg down across the throat.
And you know, Dixie Dynamite has to be feeling the thunder. Kicks out on a two count.
He's a tough young man, and he's going to hang right in there. A lot of times in a situation like this, Phil, these guys are moving on instinct.
This has to be a grueling match for Dixie Dynamite because of the weight advantage of the dirty white boy. And once again, he seems to be trying to shake the cobwebs out. I liked it very much, Mr. Wright. Why aren't you picking on Les Thatcher? Ron Wright, very vocal as always, Les.
Absolutely. He's happy man now. He's applauding because his wrestler's in the driver's seat. He's trying to pull that mask off, and a bad move on the part of the white boy. He should have concentrated on winning the match, Phil.
Dixie Dynamite going to the corner. Now drives his head into the turnbuckle.
Tony had the advantage, but then he decided he wanted to unmask him, and that was his downfall. Dynamite pulled it out and gained a little momentum for just a minute. And now the dirty white boy back on top of the action again. Wow, he caught him with a good one there.
Right in the bridge of the nose. I'm surprised Dixie Dynamite didn't go down there.
Driving knee lift and sends the masked man to the canvas. And now the dirty white boy, feeling confident, but the masked man is right back in the middle of things. Head first into that canvas, and now Dixie Dynamite has been slowed down considerably, And again, I think the white boy is making a mistake by not trying to pin his man.
This might be all for Dixie Dynamite. White boy gets a two count.
All right. Good reversal by the masked man. And Dixie Dynamite comes out of it again.
Caught him with the knees. Now a whip across the ring. Clothesline.
Ooh, and did he catch him a hard one? We heard that one smack right down here at our table. An elbow drop, and this could be the end.
Very confident, dirty white boy now as he puts the finishing touches on this match. Oh, he's going to try to punish him more. This match should be over.
Absolutely. You know, he's cost himself a couple pins by his arrogance and wanting to taunt his opponent.
I don't know how much more Dixie Dynamite can stand. He comes out of that one.
He's out again. Yes, sir. And let's see. Well, no instructions from Ron Wright. I was waiting to see if he had any instructions for his protege.
Small package.
All right.
No, kicks out again. I don't know less how much longer this match is going to go on. Dixie Dynamite, he looks spent to me, but he still comes back.
Yes, we were talking about instinct earlier, and I think he's moving on instinct right now, Phil. He drops out of that corner, and the dirty white boy goes in shoulder first. He's hurt, and this could change the tide of battle for them, Phil.
It shows just how much tenacity the Dixie Dynamite has in going against Dirty White Boy. There's a kick to the midsection.
He's going to have to take that offense back, and he's going to have to maintain control if he's going to win it, and he may do just that. Good elbow by Dixie Dynamite, and down to the canvas goes the Dirty White Boy. Dixie with a good right hand.
Went down and in for that reserve. Way down, came back, and he's battling back.
He could pull this one out to the eyes. Dirty White Boy goes to the eyes and again comes back, shoots his way. A reversal. A good martial arts kick, and down goes the Tennessean.
Well, he's got his foot on the
ropes. In the ropes.
Thread. Yeah, Ron Wright pointing it out over here, says he's got his foot on the ropes. Break it up.
We're 1 second away from the finish there. Missing the drop kick is Dixie Dynamite. Dirty White Boy pulling up short, hang onto the ropes, pulls himself out of harm's way. Let's see what's going to happen here. And unless I miss my guess, that's the Buckstore Blaster. And the winner of the first tournament match in the first round, the Dirty White Boy.
Okay, fans, like I promised again, another fan favorite right here, or my favorite at least, a nature boy, Buddy Landell, a man I think may rue Smoky Mountain Wrestling. You're going in the ring, first round action, against Primetime Brian Lee.
Let me tell you something, Primetime. We're not talking about dinner here. We're not talking about fighting. We're talking about wrestling. You're a big guy. Them weights don't fight back. You got to walk that aisle and look at nature boy Buddy Landell right in the eyes. I don't think you're geared up for it, pal. We're getting ready to find out in a few minutes.
Primetime Brian Lee against Nature Boy Buddy Landell. Round number one in the tournament for the heavyweight championship belt of Smoky Mountain Wrestling. And look at Brian Lee moving the referee out of the way.
Buddy Landell ready to try to intimidate Primetime Brian Lee. As you heard the crowd, Primetime is a real favorite here in the Smoky Mountain area. Oh.
Kick to the midsection. Drives that right hand to the side of the head. Another kick. Landell opening up now. He was trying to surprise Brian Lee, and he has done that. A series of right hands to the head, and Lee is on the rope. Young Brian, whoa, caught him with a good clothesline, Phil.
Shows you the strength of Primetime. Just picked Landell up and threw him halfway across the ring on that count.
Look here, Landell going to the eyes.
Breaking his fingers across the eyes of Primetime Brian Lee. Now up the back.
Landell is smart enough to know not to try and match strength for strength with Lee, so he's going to try and beat him down, blind him, intimidate him, antagonize him, and hopefully pin him. Nice snap mare, front face lock now. And as the referee goes in to check for the choke, look at the foot of Buddy Landell.
Bridging on that top strand of ropes. Referee didn't see it, looks up. Fans getting into this. They saw it. Referee didn't.
Landell will keep him down there, try and choke his wind off for as long as he can, and realizing that, again, it comes back to the all-important wind.
The winner of this match, of course, moves on in the Smoky Mountain Heavyweight Tournament, the Volunteer Slam, and the fans are into this tournament.
They certainly are.
We don't know. We can't pick a winner. We've had one good match. We've got a good match going here. It's anybody's tournament.
Absolutely. These are both good wrestlers. You've got a difference in age, a difference in experience, a difference in size, which makes it all the more interesting as Landell chopped and now biting at the eyes and the nose of primetime Brian Lee.
We've got a match coming up we'll be talking about, too. White Lightning Tim Horner against Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff.
That was the main event any place you take it, Phil.
Orndorff says he is going to walk away with the Smoky Mountain Heavyweight Championship belt. He's that confident.
I've never known Paul not to have confidence. But it takes a little bit of that, too, or a lot of it, actually, Phil.
Primetime Brian Lee taking the full measure of Nature Boy Buddy Landell.
Brian needs to turn it around here. Landell has been slowly but surely.
Oh, wait a minute.
The clothesline didn't work.
Yeah, ran into a brick wall. I picks him up by the collarbone.
Brian Lee goes a little choking of his own as he moves in on Buddy Landell. Landell in that corner, and Brian Lee working away with those right hands to the head. Cross corner now, and he goes. Landell stops him. Here's where the experience paid off for Buddy Landell.
Primetime Brian, a little bit too anxious to get in that corner. Use the corner against Landell. Scoop.
Power slam. Oh, he got him a good one on that one. And Brian Lee is ready to go to work now on Buddy Landell. Up to that top rope. Missing the knee from that altitude, he could have put himself in a very, very bad position now, Phil.
I think Landell was expecting that because he's seen primetime work, and primetime likes to get up to the top strand of ropes.
He's trying to put more pressure. Here he goes, trying to figure four, but look here. Primetime!
Ladies and gentlemen, he'll be facing Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff. Here he is, White Lightning Tim Horner. Tim?
You know, I've been waiting for this night for a long time, Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff. You know, you came into Smoky Mountain Wrestling, and all you wanted to do was degrade the people, degrade everybody in Smoky Mountain Wrestling, and seemed like you just wanted to pile drive your way to the top, which you knew was illegal. Well, I'll tell you what, like I said, I've been waiting tonight, but I got something for you, Paul Orndorff. All I'm going to do is going to do my best for the people of East Tennessee, for the people of Smoky Mountain Wrestling. And when it's all over, hopefully, Paul Orndorff, I can get by you and go on to win the Smoky Mountain Heavyweight title.
Let's go back to the ring.
From Morristown, Tennessee, weighing in at 230 pounds, White Lightning Tim Horner. And his opponent, he's from Atlanta, Georgia, at 242 pounds, Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff!
First round of the tournament, match number three. Paul Orndorff squaring off with White Lightning, Timmy Horner. And you were mentioning to me before these guys got in the ring,
yeah,
that when you and I were doing a program here together, Tim Horner was playing football at Morristown High School.
Right, and we were able to call his first match on television, if you'll recall.
Yes,
too.
I do remember, and he's come a long way. In fact, at one time, he was teaming with Commissioner Bob Armstrong's son, Brad. They were the tag team champions. Tim has done a lot of good things, singles-wise and tag team-wise. He's a great young wrestler, and of course, what can you say about Paul Orndorff? He's held many titles. He's wrestled the best. And as I said earlier, this match is a main event anywhere in the country.
Right, unless you know these two same wrestlers were in the ring right here in Knoxville, Tennessee, many, many years ago when Horner was first starting.
And, they sure
and
were.
Paul working here.
And watch the intimidation here. Watch them getting each other's faces.
Now, wait a minute. Orndorff is looking at a different wrestler here now. He's not going to intimidate him.
Paul can go either way. He can brawl with you. He can wrestle with you. And, of course, Timmy prefers to do the scientific style. He's a flyer. He's a man with drop kicks and head scissors, but he can get in there and brawl with the best of them.
And, you know, we want to point out that Commissioner Bob Armstrong has ruled that the pile driver is illegal, and Dorndorf is very upset. Armstrong is watching this match off out of the Coliseum in another room to make sure that everything goes according to plan.
Well, you know, Orndorff's made a lot of derogatory remarks about the people in this area, and of course, Tim is from this area, so you might say he is representing the fans that watch Smoky Mountain Wrestling.
Orndorff calls the fans of Smoky Mountain Championship Wrestling hillbillies. He doesn't like the hillbilly wife. He's had a lot of derogatory comments, and Tim is just the opposite. Orndorff has done a turnaround from what he used to be years and years ago.
Yes, sir. He prefers to cut the corners. He's a back alley brawler. As I said, he can wrestle.
Yeah.
The thing is, he could get in there and get down on his fours and go with anybody. But he prefers the shortcuts. But there you go. The wrestling move out of that headlock. The reversal by Tim. Drop toe hold by Orndorff. Over the top, Tim back into that hammerlock. And we're seeing some great catch-as-catch-can style wrestling, Phil.
There you go. Both men have had championships. Both men have worn the belt. They know what it feels like to be a champion, to wear that championship belt. And so you're looking at two great wrestlers and a great match right here starting out.
You know, a lot of fans get excited when they see these guys going toe-to-toe, throwing the punches, or when they see the drop kicks and the flying head scissors. But what you just witnessed now on that canvas, hold and counter-hold, takes a lot of skill and a lot of talent as well. And please give these guys all the credit in the world for what they're doing there. Nice fireman's carry by Paul Orndorff. You mentioned his wrestling. He hasn't forgotten it.
Right, and Horner comes up with the head scissors. So we're seeing some top-notch wrestling and some great moves right here in this match.
Yes, sir. Both guys trying to establish a position offensively here, and neither man able to hang on for any length of time. But, of course, both of them are spending some energy. So at some point, somebody's got to make a mistake. And as I mentioned earlier, if you are going to pick a winner of this tournament, it's going to be milliseconds and minute little mistakes that's going to cost somebody.
Horner caught a couple of elbows across the face, across the bridge of the nose. Now gets a kick into the midsection as Orndorff is going to work on Tim Horner.
Reversal by White Lightning and a shot to the chest drives Orndorff down and out. Horner, is he going to come off that top? No, the referee is going to bring him down. He starts his count. You know, one thing for sure, Orndorff relied heavily on that pile driver, and Commissioner Bob Armstrong has taken that pile driver away from him.
Well, as a former wrestler yourself, Les, what happens when you're used to depending on a move, a certain way of winning a match, and that's taken away from you?
Well, when I was a young man, the old-timers told me, kid, don't be a one-hold wrestler.
Right.
And I'm assuming that the man we're looking at here, Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff, is more than a one-hold wrestler. He's got something up his sleeve, Phil. You can be guaranteed of that.
Well, he's had plenty of time to think about it as he's gone through this tournament, knowing that without the pile driver, he's got to come up with a new way, a new twist of winning this match. We'll just have to see how it unfolds.
But I will say this. It's his favorite hold, and if they take your favorite hold away by instinct alone, you may go for it. The problem here, if he goes for it and is successful in getting it, it will cost him the match. It won't win it for him.
Right. As we pointed out at the head of this match, that Commissioner Bob Armstrong is standing by watching every move.
Orndorff catapults Horner off. Tim with a nice tackle. Orndorff down over the top. He can move. Misses the clothesline. Flying body press. And a two count almost. Tim Horner almost pulled that one out.
Advantage right now is definitely in Orndorff's corner as he's still driving that foot in or boot into the rib cage of Tim Horner.
Right. Lightning's in trouble now. Orndorff has definitely got a decided advantage here, and he's going out. Let's see where he's adjusting that knee pad, and I'm not really sure. We're talking about weapons. We're talking about favorite holds.
Elbow across Horner's throat as he hangs onto the ropes. Orndorff setting up again.
Ooh. A bad one there, and Tim going out head first onto that floor on the other side of the ring for us. We can't see him, but he is down, and he definitely has to be stunned by that onslaught.
We can't see the action here, Les, because we have no television monitors, but Orndorff right now is getting a count from the referee to break the hold, and he does.
Tim Horner coming up slowly, very slowly now.
Referee!
And this is the biggest gap between the two wrestlers since the bell rang to start the match. Orndorff definitely in the driver's seat at this point.
It's been toe-to-toe since the opening bell in this match, and we are seeing one of the great matches of this first ever Smoky Mountain tournament. Again, he drives Horner off of the edge of the apron into the concrete floor.
He came full bore with that knee. And of course, we want to remind you in this first round that the Dirty White Boy came up with a win over Dixie Dynamite. And primetime Brian Lee aced Nature Boy Buddy Landell. So those are two of the guys who are going to be moving into the second round. And of course, the winner of this match will be doing the same.
This has been a grueling match for Tim Horner as he has taken the brunt of the offering of Paul Orndorff as he drives that elbow into his throat now. How much more can Horner stand?
This is where Wonderful excels. He has the advantage. He will move in. Watch him. He's methodical. He's picking Timmy apart. Timmy's only chance here is to slow Orndorff down, to get out of that ring and take the count.
Right, get out of the ring as fast as he can. Some of the fans behind us saying, check the knee pads of Paul Orndorff. He could have loaded them. I didn't see it, Liz.
He very well could have. I saw him make an adjustment, whether he was just pulling it up or whether actually he was doing something with it. Phil, I have no idea.
He's saying the referee, and he's talking to the fans. He said, he's mine now, darling.
Wonder what he's setting him up here for. I would say the pile driver any other time, but of course, as we said, the pile driver is illegal here. Commissioner Bob Armstrong has says no go for the pile driver.
Horner's been able to match Orndorff move for move in the early minutes of this match, but after Orndorff went to work on that left arm and then the left leg, he's put Tim Horner in, he's put him in a lot of trouble.
Timmy trying to fight his way out here, and again, he's in a position where he has to exert that energy and that precious wind to fight his away from Orndorff. Orndorff getting a break at this point. He's in the driver's seat. And once Paul gets an advantage, he is a hard man to take it away from.
Well, he's got the leverage, and that's giving him a chance to rest. And Horner is still trying to break this hold.
Applying that pressure at the chin, his knee, in the back of the neck. Tim, I know, is having a tough time breathing. It is not a choke hold. The hand is cupped up under the chin. But again, Tim reaching out, trying to maintain. Let's see if he's going to be able to pull it up. He's reaching down deep, going for that second effort. Horner's on his feet. And,
Horner trying to come back, but just as he got ahead of steam up, it was cut short with that clothesline by Paul Orndorff. And Orndorff again shows the mastery over Tim Horner at this point in the match.
You watch. Oh, he drove that fist from the top down. And a two count. Horner's still in this one. Timmy Horner is a lot of man. He's a tough one. He doesn't give anything easily away to his opponents. And I think Paul Orndorff's finding that out now. Horner coming up slowly. Oh-ho, in behind him on the cradle. But couldn't hang on. Timmy didn't have the power to hang on to him on that one, Phil.
Orndorff raked his fingers across the eyes of Tim Horner.
Orndorff's making an adjustment on the knee pad, but I don't know.
I've had my eye on it here for the last two or three minutes. He still reaches down to adjust it, but maybe it's just because it's slipping. Who knows?
It could be. And the way he came across that ring, Timmy did go down with like a shot, but it's hard to say. Tim needs to get outside. Again, that all precious win is gone. Orndorff now methodically just taking Horner's offense apart.
Horner's taking a lot of punishment with those kicks to Paul Orndorff. Oh, Horner comes back with one of his own there.
Fighting back. He's going to need to be more aggressive than that to keep on top of him. There he goes, the right hand. Let's see if he can take over at this point. Orndorff shooting back at him now. He caught Orndorff by surprise and got the advantage, and he may well keep it. It looked like Orndorff went low that time again.
Caught him with a chop to the throat.
15 minutes have expired. There are 5 minutes left in the match.
This match has gone 15 minutes less. I wouldn't be a bit surprised if it doesn't go the remaining five.
But you know what? 5 minutes ago, I would have put my money on Paul Orndorff, but Orndorff is tired now. He's being worn down, and Horner is tough as nails. He's hanging in there.
Oh! Jim Horner.
Another plus for Tim Horner, and now Orndorff's fighting for air.
Just as he started to come down, Horner drew up his knees and caught Orndorff in the stomach.
Right hand by Timmy, and another one. He's setting him up. He's going to try and take him home here. Good elbow, good elbow.
Referee, Mark.
Horner could put him away, Phil. He could pull this one out.
Into the turnbuckle goes Orndorff. I think that knee to the midsection took the wind out of Orndorff's sails.
Here, going for the suplex, takes him on the short ride. Let's see if he can hold on for that three count. Orndorff out on two and about a half.
Well, we have about 4 minutes remaining in this match, Les, so it has been Fist City all the way.
We're seeing the same situation here with Orndorff that Horner was in just moments ago. But now Tim Horner has a very good chance of moving to the second round.
Again, Horner drives Orndorff's head into the top turnbuckle. He looks a little groggy, Les.
Short little shoulder to right hand. Sends him cross ring. Be careful, Timmy. Went to the well once too often, and Paul Orndorff, the veteran that he is, saw through it, anticipated it, and was waiting with the elbow. Uh-oh, Timmy's got him, reverses it. Backslides him, but only gets a two count. Couldn't maintain. Orndorff overbalanced him and broke free. Small package. And again, a near pin. So close and yet so far, Phil.
2 minutes, a little over 2 minutes remaining in this match. And here's Orndorff. Gonna stand him up high.
Right in midair. Timmy turns it around, drops down. He's hooking that sleeper if he can hang on. Let's see what happens here.
There are 2 minutes left in the match.
Horner hanging on, wearing Orndorff down. Orndorff down to his knees now, looking to grab the top rope or the midsection rope. Finally gets a hand on it. The referee doesn't. Yeah, he sees it. Starts to count.
Timmy could have hung on mid-ring on that. That would have been it. Once you're in the sleeper, you don't fight out of that one.
He had him for the ride on that one.
Orndorff grabs the trunks, drops down, and shoots Horner through the ropes and onto the floor. Orndorff brings him right over on top of us into the table head first. The referee's starting to count now on both wrestlers, and again, head first into the timer. Horner blocks it, and Orndorff goes head first into the timer's table.
Well, you can't get any closer to the action than we are right now, as both men using the table we're working from.
Horner back into the ring. There's still standing around outside. 1 minute to go in this match, and yet we have no winner.
As you pointed out, 5 minutes ago would have never gone this distance.
The foot was hooked under the rope. We'll see what happens. Watch it, Orndorff's going to unhook it. The referee did not see the leg hooked under the rope, and as he turned away to call for the bell, Orndorff unhooked the leg.
Rock and roll, Robert Gibson.
And right off of the bat, Jimmy Golden goes after Robert Gibson before the bell even sounds.
You know, there's been bad blood between these two guys over the last several weeks, and I think they're happy that they are meeting in this pairing in the first round of this tournament, Phil.
Now, Gibson, of course, had a great tag team success with Ricky Morton, but Golden did quite well with Robert Fuller.
That's right. They both have held numerous tag team titles with their partners, and now we're seeing them going after singles titles, which they both are very talented at also.
Takes a lot of strength to scoop big Jimmy Golden up. So you see the strength of rock and roll Robert Gibson in the opening minute of this match.
Both of these guys, you know, come from wrestling backgrounds. Robert's older brother, Ricky, was quite an accomplished professional wrestler, and he also wrestled here in this area a number of years ago. Jimmy Golden, through marriage, is related to the Fullers, the Fields, the Welches, all wrestling families. His father was a wrestling promoter throughout the Southeast a number of years ago, Bill Golden. So these guys both grew up in teething rings, were turnbuckles, Phil.
You know, when I look across the ring at Jimmy Golden, Les, he hasn't changed at all since 1974, 75. He still looks the same.
He certainly does. He's a tough man. He's a tough man.
I'd like to have a nickel for every time he's been in the ring. A lot of experience in Jimmy Golden, and as you pointed out, Robert Gibson, no stranger to the ring.
And as you see right now, Robert won't take any guff. He's going to battle him right back. He climbs right up in the saddle and starts wailing away.
Jimmy Golden's got the height, but he doesn't intimidate Robert Gibson.
There's Golden going into the back of that knee. No. Threw that shoulder in, driving that knee.
Quick way to put a man out of commission is go for the knee. When that goes, the match goes.
Well, as you can see by that one maneuver, this man says, whatever it takes to win this one, that's what I'm going to put out.
And right there again, we see where he's got the weakest point, as we mentioned earlier, and he's going to work on it.
It appears he's going to stay with that knee. And, of course, we're talking about two very ring-savvy gentlemen here. Both these guys are tough. And I keep repeating this, but this tournament is not going to be won by a landslide by anyone.
No.
It's going to be by someone else's minor mistake or by a matter of a second here or a wrong move there, because we have some top wrestling talent here in the Smoky Mountain tournament.
Step over toehold by Jimmy Golden, now reverses, now goes again for that step over toehold.
He's spinning. This hold that was used by several wrestlers over the years as a finisher, Jimmy's using it right now to wear down Robert Gibson and using the rope for a little added leverage. We're so far moving into the second round. We've got some tough competitors. Dirty White Boy, Paul Orndorff. Both tough wrestlers. They're in that second round. Young Brian Lee. And you know, Brian, I won't say a rose between the thorns, but he's the youngster, the new kid on the block, so to speak. And both Orndorff and White Boy are rugged veterans. And you got two veterans in here now, so Brian's traveling in fast company.
I think Buddy Landell got a surprise with primetime Brian Lee. He thought he was going to waltz in here, win this first round, but it didn't happen that way.
Absolutely.
Gibson favoring that left knee as Golden again kicks away.
Robert shooting back at him, but if he can't stay up on his feet, and there again, Golden goes back to that leg. And obviously, that's the body part. If you go after one of the legs, the man's going to have a tough time beating it on one leg.
After working a while on that left leg, he bangs it into the apron on the ring, and he's got rock and roll Robert Gibson right where he wants it.
Jimmy right back in and goes to that knee. Gibson in trouble. He needs to rest that knee if at all possible. A lot of times you see these wrestlers roll out and take the count. A lot of people say, well, the guy's a coward, the guy's chicken. He's an opportunist, and he's trying to rest, and that's what it's about. You're in here for a big payday, and the winners come up with more than the losers, so you want to get that hand held up if you can.
Well, it's not like a boxer getting in the corner, covering up, trying to get that extra breath.
Absolutely. Looks like Jimmy's going to take him down to that ring post now.
Oh, no. No, come on, Golden.
Brings that knee around against that steel ring post, and Robert Gibson is in trouble now.
How much more can Gibson take as he works on that left knee?
This gentleman's surprising. When you think he's gone, he'll come firing back at you. Golden moving in now, kicking into the midsection. I don't know here, Phil. I think if I were, I'd be grabbing at that leg and trying to get him in a Boston Crab, trying to some way see if I couldn't get a submission.
Well,
I don't know if you heard me. I'm not his manager, but he is going for a half crab.
Come on, you call that. Well, that's where the wrestling experience, a former wrestler like yourself, comes into play here, because you know what to do, what to follow up with.
I hadn't suggested the ropes for leverage. Goalie with a half crab, yanking on those ropes to get as much leverage as you can, put the pressure on that knee. That's right. This is the final match of the first round of the tournament for the heavyweight championship of Smoky Mountain Wrestling. Look at Robert. Look at Robert using that free leg to kick Golden alongside the head. Jimmy's trying to shake the cobwebs out. Robert to the midsection with that right hand and a right looping right hand alongside the head.
And he's hopping around on one leg and still giving Golden all he wants.
Jimmy grabs the headlock. As he tries to take Robert head first into that post, Robert shoots him off. Golden into that post with his shoulder. Let's see what happens from here. Both men are hurting now, Phil.
Golden catches Gibson in the leg as he starts to climb through the ring, got him hung on the ropes and still banging away.
Golden with that leg again. Robert trying to stay on his feet, trying to make, look at that. Beautiful Savat kick to the side of the head. He couldn't get the other foot under him, so he did the next best thing, coming up in the air with that Savat kick to the side of the head. Now Robert Gibson trying to bring himself up, trying to get his pins under him. A little stability would help him here in his fight to make a comeback.
Caught Golden with a knee as he's coming in. Now another kick to the midsection. Golden's down.
A driving knee lift. And Golden stunned now, giving Robert a chance to get a little circulation going in that leg. Let's see what happens here as he shoots him off, cross ring into the ropes. Starts to take for the backdrop, but look at there. Golden grabs the hair and throws Gibson away. Right back to that knee, Phil.
We've talked about this so much in this match right here. Golden has continued to work on that left knee. Now drives a fist into the forehead of Robert Gibson. Gibson holding onto the ropes. Golden tries to get him to the center of the ring and goes again to that left knee.
And of course, obviously, both these guys are hurting, but the winner's got to come back in another round, and whoever the winner is, he could come back at a disadvantage, Phil.
How much is a disadvantage working in two matches, possibly three in a tournament like this?
Well, obviously, your stamina and energy are depleted. Let's see it. Wow, he got it. Got it.
Hey, Bulldog Golden right into the canvas and comes up with a win.
Jimmy tried to set it up. He backfired it. Robert Gibson with a bulldog and a body press. Over Jimmy Golden in the first round of the tournament for the heavyweight championship of Smoky Mountain Wrestling.
Well, the first round of the heavyweight tournament is over, Phil, and we're going to the semifinals. But in that first round, the Dirty White Boy defeated Dixie Dynamite.
And Buddy Landell was a loser to primetime Brian Lee.
And Paul Orndorff escaped with his hair and was able to eke out a win over Timmy Horner.
And in our fourth match of the first round, it was Jimmy Golden losing to Rock and Roll Robert Gibson.
So those will be your contestants in the semifinal round. And right now, let's go to the ring to start the semifinals of the heavyweight tournament.
Weighing in at 248 pounds from Buckstar, Tennessee, the Dirty White Boy. And his manager, Mr. Ron Wright. His opponent,
Smoky Mountain Wrestling, Phil.
And old Primetime just goes right to work on the Dirty White Boy, and it's Fist City once again here in the Volunteer Slam Smoky Mountain Heavyweight Tournament.
You know this young Brian Lee, he's big, he's tough, he can wrestle.
Right again, they use our work here as a place for the battering ram, the head of the Dirty White Boy. Primetime Brian Lee goes right at him. Primetime got to this match by winning over Buddy Landell. Dirty White Boy defeated Dixie Dynamite to move into the second round.
You know, it looks like young Brian's trying to shut this one down early. He's got to realize that he got a veteran on his hands who can be tough. But you know, Brian Lee, I never said anyone was unbeatable, but this young man is like a runaway locomotive, and he's got the endurance, the drive, the size, and he knows how to wrestle, Phil.
One thing about it, he is a crowd pleaser, a real fan favorite here, but you can't count Ron Wright out because he's ringside in his wheelchair, and he knows how to pull out the tricks.
He certainly does. And, of course, Tony, the Dirty White Boy, you know he's a street fighter. He'll do whatever it takes to win or anything to win. And of course, that's the Ron Wright School of Professional Wrestling anyway.
Well, Primetime went right at the Dirty White Boy, not giving him a chance to get an advantage. And he has been after him like a bulldog throughout this opening minutes of the match.
Dirty White Boy trying to buy some time, and he's buying it now. Let's see what's Brian Lee going to do with Ron Wright here. Nothing as the White Boy comes back to save his manager, grabs Brian Lee and starts pummeling his head.
Wright cut him off as he was trying to get around to the Dirty White Boy.
Dirty White Boy took him head first into that poke. He hit his head on that timekeeper's bell, Bill, and now he's taking him into that post. He could do a lot of damage with him there.
Dirty White Boy biting the forehead of Primetime Brian Lee. Working on that forehead, outside of the ring, got a chokehold on it. Referee starting the count.
As I said, White Boy's a back alley brawler, and he's showing it here. Both these guys opened up early. This one can't last too long, Phil. They're going to run out of gas.
They've already gone 10 minutes in the first round, a little bit longer to get to where they are in this match. We're in the second round now of the Volunteer Slam. And we started off with a bang as Primetime Brian Lee hit the ring against the Dirty White Boy.
Brian having trouble now. He caught two bad ones, one in the ring post, one on the timekeeper's bell. Tony drags him. Oh, he is cut. He is open. White Boy opened him up either on the bell or on that post, I'm not sure which, but he has been lacerated.
He hit him with full force against that bell at the other end of our table here, Les. Flies that foot to the throat. Primetime Brian Lee's in trouble.
They both wanted to take it home early, but obviously and decidedly the advantage belongs to the Dirty White Boy now. Brian Lee is bleeding profusely. That's a bad one. His face is covered with blood. And a White Boy trying to choke him down now. And Ron Wright is a big smile on his face as he wheels around the outside of the ring. Brian's tough. I don't want to count him out, Phil.
The way he came after the Dirty White Boy in the opening minutes of this round, we won't count him out either because he's got a lot of stamina.
Across the ring, White Boy gets him with that clothesline, dropped it. The pin pops under him, and down goes Tony with that shot to the head.
Well, yeah, here Wright's back again, mouthing off at me.
Dirty
I know
White
you
Boy.
Use your head there, right? Right.
Ron Wright will take credit for this, right?
Right.
He'll take credit if his boy wins. I wonder if he'll take credit if he happens to lose this one.
Well, I'm still waiting for him to come out of that chair.
Brian is in trouble. Right now, he is turned into a punching bag for the Dirty White Boy. The Bucksthorpe, Tennessee native is a happy, happy man.
He says we're looking at the next champion, baby. All right. Yeah, Wright says he wished he could stand up and get out of the wheelchair.
Well, like I said, I don't know the miracles, but Brian's trying to get himself to his feet now. He's trying to stand up. Primetime, Brian Lee. A lot of respect for a young man. Short on experience, Phil, but right now he's got a tough street battler that has really got a decided advantage, and this could push the Dirty White Boy into that final round.
He's felt those motorcycle boots more than one time in this match tonight. Whips him across the ring into the turnbuckles and a clothesline to boot.
And brought him out dead center and drops him. Brian Lee basically out on his feet, it seems like here, Phil, trying to see him wiping, trying to wipe the blood out of his eyes.
We've seen some exciting action here on the first ever Volunteer Slam, and tonight we are crowning a heavyweight champion. It's anybody's tournament so far.
It sure is. I keep going back to the, you can't call it from the outset. It could belong to anybody that's still in there, and I won't rule Brian Lee out. I won't rule the Dirty White Boy, Paul Orndorff, Robert Gibson. They're all tough, they're all great, and they're all wired for this one.
So far, Dixie Dynamite, Landell, Horner, and Golden have been eliminated.
A power slam by the White Boy. He'll try for the pin here. Two count, and just about a 2.5. Prime Time brings the shoulder up and shuts the door on a possible win for the White Boy at this point.
Ron Wright wanting the timekeeper to ring the bell.
I'm sure he does. Ryan's still able to stand up, and he has lost quite a bit of blood already. I mean, that blonde hair is almost red from the middle of his head to his forehead.
Swinging wildly, Prime Time Riley not able to connect. And Dirty White Boy is telling Prime Time he owns him now. He's the master.
And this is where the Dirty White Boy is going to savor it, Bill. He's got him where he wants him. Look at him. Now he's insulting him. Now he's humiliating him.
I don't know how much more Prime Time Brian Lee can take in this match. And I know that Jim Cornette is somewhere watching this match and saying, attaboy, Dirty White Boy.
No doubt about that. Right now, Brian, tied up in those ropes, has nothing going for him at all. Doesn't seem like he's able to pull himself, barely holding his head up at this point, Phil.
And the Dirty White Boy says, this match is for you, Mr. Wright. He's giving Prime Time Brian Lee all he wants.
And Brian is in trouble. I don't think right now the White Boy wants to put him away. I think he just wants to enjoy this. He wants to put on a show for the people, and he wants to impress his mentor, Ron Wright.
Had Prime Time draped on the ropes here just a couple of seconds ago. Now he's got him up by the other hand and puts the fist into the forehead.
Brian
still on his feet.
He's staggering around there, Phil. It's on instinct alone at this point. Whoa! He shot that. Look at that right hand go into that chin. He straightens him up with that one. Three good shots to the head.
Snapping that head back.
The fans are chanting, go, Brian, go. They can't hear him through our microphones. Whoa! Brian with a supreme second effort. Drives that shoulder, that short shoulder. Look at him coming again, Phil.
Looks like he's hitting that tackling dummy there.
You got to admire this little man. But the White Boy right back in it.
Unless he's fighting back all the way, I think he's giving it that second and third effort now because he has been mauled by the Dirty White Boy in this match.
Ryan is mad. And this young man, the adrenaline is flowing. Look at here, we got a punch out one, and Brian Lee is showing you why they call him Prime Time.
Caught the Dirty White Boy with a roundhouse there. White Boy backing off on the ropes.
Brian with the clothesline. Down goes the Dirty White Boy, Brian Lee, in the driver's seat. And he's trying to take the battle to the Dirty White Boy. Look at the drop kick.
10 minutes have elapsed. 20 minutes remaining in the round.
A grueling, tough 10 minutes gone into this match thus far. Prime Time catches a foot in the throat. Dirty White Boy has him by the hair of the head. Center ring.
He has slowed him down, but at this point, the White Boy has got to understand if he's going to put this young gentleman away, it's going to have to be quick, Phil.
White Boy going to that second strand of ropes. Misses on the fly.
Whoa! White Boy hit first into the canvas, and a three count for Prime Time, Ryan Lee. Look out now. Look out now, the White Boy.
Prime Time, Brian Lee.
And look here, Dirty White Boy just grabbed the chair, and he's going to work on Brian Lee. Brian has lost a lot of blood. He has lost a lot of blood. He is weak, Bill, and he is now at the mercy of Dirty White Boy.
So far, he's been hit with that chair three times. Quivering, trying to work his way out of the ring. White Boy, not relenting at all.
Brian's shoulder seems to be bothering him. He hit him with, caught him with that chair. Several good shots. Although Brian Lee is the winner, he will move into the final round, Bill. He will move there if he can stand, if he can walk, if he can wrestle.
Okay, you little brain surgeon, that's right. I'm waiting for the Dirty White Boy to come in here. He's right here with me.
It's just not right. The biggest fluke that has ever hit this planet. Brought down Brian Lee. You lucked up, brother. There's not a chance in you nowhere that you could ever, ever beat me again. Well, let me tell you something, prime time, Brian Lee. I may not become the Smoky Mountain heavyweight champion tonight, but brother, neither will you, because I'll make sure that you don't win this belt.
Prime time, I'd hate to be you.
Tournament semifinal match number two, Rock and Roll Robert Gibson out against Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff. And this should be a barn burner. Orndorff barely slipping by Tim Horner in the first round without the use of his pile driver, and Gibson looks like he's on a roll, Phil. This should be a hot one.
In that match you're talking about earlier with Horner, he went almost 19 and a half minutes of a 20-minute match before he pulled out the win. So he has got to be feeling this. That plus Gibson had his knee worked on, so both of them are not in tip-top shape as we go into this match.
You saw Orndorff go for that single leg, tried the leg dive. Robert scooted out of the way. Orndorff had backed him into that corner and gone for the single leg. So he'll be shooting for that knee. He'll be trying to take that knee away from him. Kicked the pins right out from under him. And Robert, on the other side of the ring from us, is most assuredly favoring that knee now. And Orndorff taking full advantage of the referee's count to do more damage.
And for the fans who are joining us on Smoky Mountain Championship Wrestling, we want to remind you that we are in the second round of the Volunteer Slam Tournament, and we've had six exciting matches so far.
Robert hobbling now. Orndorff moving right and going to work on that leg again, and again to the knee. He's trying to stretch those ligaments. You got to give Robert a lot of credit. He's game. He's hanging in there. He's playing it tough, Phil.
He took a lot of punishment from the last match.
Orndorff with a series of elbows into the knee, and a looping upper right hand that catches Gibson in the chin and straightens him up. Robert telling the referee not to touch the leg. It must be sensitive at this point, and rightly so. Robert trying to maintain balance, stay on his feet. Orndorff moving in. Orndorff is what you call a money ball player. He sees the goal line, he senses a chance to put him away, and he's not going to give him an inch, Phil.
Like you said earlier, Les, he is going to be the Smoky Mountain heavyweight champion. He came in here with that idea, and so far, his game plan has been successful.
Absolutely, but of course, we've seen several gentlemen tonight fall by the wayside who had that same game plan in mind.
Tim Horner won, it was eliminated. Dixie Dynamite eliminated.
Jimmy Golden. Buddy Landell, top flight athletes, all top wrestlers.
And they have held belts in this area, too.
Yes, sir. Whoa! Paul paying too much attention to the fans, not enough to Gibson, and Robert opens up on him, and Robert now putting Orndorff to the test.
Well, you can't let your emotions run away with you. You've got to keep your eye on the bullseye.
Smart move on Gibson's part. A couple of short steps. He knew he couldn't go too far. Got the little clothesline, and let's see if those legs are going to hold up for him. Orndorff, and a reversal again. Yeah. Robert. Orndorff hooked the arm, and Robert couldn't balance himself. The knee give out on him. Couldn't bring him over with a hip lock. Bulldog. And Orndorff gets a foot on the rope. Good move on Gibson's part. He saw him coming. He countered with a bulldog. Had a chance to pin him, but they were too close to the ropes. Orndorff got the leg over the bottom strand. And now, wait a minute. Whoa. Took an out from under him.
Submarine tackle on that left leg. Got him rolled up. And
there it is. A three count. Your winner. And moving to the final round is Paul Orndorff. He wins over Robert Gibson.
Okay, fans, right here with me right now, Jim Cornette and the Heavenly Bodies going into the ring against the Party Patrol, the Riches. What do you think, Jim?
What are they patrolling for? What are they looking for? I'll tell you what they're going to be looking for, the back door out of the Knoxville Civic Coliseum, brother, when they get in a ring with the greatest tag team in the universe. Let me tell you something, Johnny and Davey Rich. I don't know what kind of parties you're used to going to. I don't know whether you maybe take a drink. I don't know what you do. But I'll guarantee you, after this match, you're going to get arrested for WRAF. Walking recklessly and attempting to fall. Right, boys?
Let me tell you something, guys. This ain't no party. This is serious business. Serious Heavenly Body business. We don't party. We come here to fight. In Knoxville, Tennessee, guys, this will be your last party.
In just a few short moments, Stan, the Party Patrol will be walking down the aisle, and everybody's going to be patting them on the back saying, go, guys, go. Get in the ring and show us what you got against the tag team champions. But as they're soon going to learn, soon going to find out, there's not too much distance between a pat in the back and a kick in the pants when you get in the ring with the Heavenly Bodies.
Okay. And I want to say one more thing. All you big, fat, ugly, corn-fed farm women, don't pull their hair, don't touch their bodies, and watch out because these robes are expensive. In other words, stay away because we don't want nothing to do with you.
Great, great words, Jim. Let's take it back to the ring right now.
Television program. Stanley, Dr. Tom Pritchard are the current Smoky Mountain Tag Team Champions, winning over Jackie Fulton.
Uh-huh.
And the Fantastic.
Look at here.
Bring on the action.
Hip.
I've lost track of the legal man in the ring, Les. Who is it?
I have lost track as well. If I have to make a pick, I don't know.
Well, Jim Cornette's taking the belt. He's starting toward the dressing room. He says it's over. Mark Curtis, the referee, is not going to let him get away with it. He's going to bring him back here. The Richards are still in the ring.
What I see coming here, Phil, is Lane and Pritchard have gone with a speed route, but the Richards are able to hang with them move for move. I would think that if I were Cornette or in Cornette's shoes, I'd be telling Stan and Tommy, slow it down, keep them on our side of the ring, and wear them down.
He's buying time right now by getting outside the ring, taking the belt till they come back. Well, this is not a football game, but Stan Lane asked for timeout.
Yes.
Well, they want to settle things down, shake hands. I don't think I would trust him if I was Davey Rich. Cornette's got something up his sleeve when he took him out of the ring. Had a little conference there, Les.
And I think if Davey reaches in there, he's going to pull back more than he bargained for.
Yeah. I was watching Cornette just a moment ago, a little furrows in his brow. He is worried about his team retaining this championship against the Party Patrol.
I'll say this for Jim. He's like a mother hen. He's always worried about what's going on. He must worry off 2 or 3 pounds for every match that he sits in a corner.
Once again, Mark Curtis cautioning Davey Rich, who shakes his head and says, I don't know what you're talking about, ref.
He must have thrown the forearm, as he's demonstrating to the referee. And of course, Stan is telling the referee to the contrary.
Well, he's protesting anyway.
Lane's buying time here.
Yeah.
Stan's taking as much time as he can. He knows that they can't go back to the speed thing with these guys. They're going to have to take time. They're going to have to slow it down. When they get an advantage, they're going to have to hang on to it.
This is getting to be a chess game. A little finesse on both sides here, Les.
It certainly is. And of course, wrestling, you and I have talked about, it is human chess. It's
right.
Move and counter move. Battle for who's going to come up with a top wrist lock here. And with a handful of hair, Lane gets himself out of the problem. Tommy Pritchard in, but he's hooked. Taken over with a hip roll. Collar and elbow now. Davey Rich on the move, but he's caught with a knee. And it's a clothesline from the back. And it's the 1-2 punch of Lane and Pritchard that slows things down. And I think here's where you're going to see these guys start to excel.
Well, Cornette must have opened his book of moves and picked out the right one on that, or just said, okay, guys, you're on your own, go for it. We've seen him pull out all the stops in this last 2 or 3 minutes.
I don't know if you caught it or not, but as Pritchard went to throw Davey Rich off, he slapped his own knee, which was his signal to Lane to set it up. I'm going to be dropped down. He's got to come over the top. And that's what teamwork is all about. That's why they're the champion.
And that's why we talked about how much the moving in and out of the ring and knowing what your partner's going to do. Helps out. Look at there. Oh, my goodness.
Stan the man spun him in midair with that clothesline. And Davey Rich is motionless on that canvas. Double teaming now. This is where Pritchard and Lane excel.
And the referee cutting off Johnny Rich, not letting him into the ring. Pritchard rolls him up. Goes for a 2 count, cannot get the 3. And Davey's back on his feet.
Young Rich is hanging tough. Head first into that top turnbuckle. Tom Pritchard trying to soften him up now. And this is what they're going to have to do. They're going to have to keep it slow. They're going to have to keep it methodical. And they're going to have to stay on top of it.
Pritchard judo chopping Rich into the throat. Now stands him up high, drops him.
The long ride on the suplex drives him into that canvas. And now Pritchard setting him up to go with the knee. They pin him here. And not quite.
Davey, the lesser experience of the two Party Patrols. Johnny has the most experience, so they've got the inexperienced man in the ring at this time.
Flying almost across the timer's table. Davey Rich in trouble now.
And here's Cornette with a tennis racket.
Cornette drives the shaft of the racket into the windpipe of Davey Rich.
And there's where we talk about the racket becoming a lethal weapon.
Also could be the turning point in this tag team championship match.
Here is Stan Lane. Well, he's going to rep the microphone cord around Davey Rich.
I don't know if you can hear him or not. He told Cornette, pull the referee. Cornette with three well-placed kicks into the solar plexus of Davey Rich. And right now, Davey is in a lot of trouble. He's taking a lot of abuse on his floor while the referee's been trying to break the melee up in the ring.
And Johnny can't get inside to help him or get outside to help him because the referee is counting. So the party patrol in real trouble here with the legal man in the ring, Davey, on the apron on the outside of the ring. Richard being held off by Mark Curtis. Now he's got a handful of hair. Let's see what he does. He motions again to Stan Lane.
Richard keeping on him, staying on top of him, pounding him down. I've got to admire the young man for coming back in the ring. He took a lot of punishment out here on this table from Lane and Cornette.
Davey Rich double team. There's the combo flip, and Rich in trouble. Johnny finally makes it into the ring list.
Now watch, behind the referee's back, Lane pitches him over the top. Stan Lane pulling the referee as Tommy Pritchard drives Davey Rich headfirst into the timer's table once again.
And yeah, we've got Davey Rich.
It may not be legal, it may not be what you want to see, but you got to know that it's teamwork between the heavenly bodies. All three of them, including the manager, know where to be and when to be there, Phil.
Davey Rich has taken a lot of punishment. Clothesline again by Stan Lane.
Lane not only clotheslined him, but used his own weight and momentum to take him down. It's made it even a more devastating move.
Lane with a chokehold. Referee's got his back turned.
You know, when your partner's in a situation like that, you're torn, you know what to do. You realize if you come in, you're pulling the referee off the situation, but if you don't come in, there's a good chance your partner's going to take a lot more punishment than he should.
There's always a chance of disqualification, too, in a championship match like this. We don't want that to happen.
Absolutely. And again, they windmill Davey Rich in midair with a double clothesline. And Dr. Style Tom Pritchard is a very happy individual at this moment.
Well, once again, he has performed a perfect operation here thus far. Let's see if he can pull it off.
Devastating suplex. That should be about all it's going to take to put Davey Rich away.
Johnny's got to do something to get in there.
Whoa! Look at Pritchard miss. And I don't even think Davey knew that he was pulling out of the way. He just moved on instinct. Pritchard came full tilt boogie onto that elbow. And if that son of a gun's not dislocated, I'll miss my guess.
He hesitated just a second too long. Pritchard makes his way to the corner. There's the tag. And Davey Rich makes the tag.
And here comes Johnny Rich. Goes to work on both Stan Lane and Tommy Pritchard. He's cleaning out. Drop kick. Chops. Punches. He sets Stan Lane up. Elbow. Goes to Pritchard with the right hand. Lane bagging off now. But let's see what Johnny's going to do. Lane reverses it. Takes. I don't know what Lane was going for, but he couldn't quite hook it. Johnny took the advantage, slid in behind him. Now, you've got four wrestlers going at it now, the referee out of control.
Again, Davey Rich using our announcing position here.
Stan Lane has Johnny Rich pinned in the ring, but Rich kicks out. Let's see where Lane goes from here. Rich with a headlock, action in the ring. For an extra, Johnny Rich. Stan Lane drops the leg. Let's see what happens here. And in the ring, a two count on Johnny Rich while Davey Rich and Tom Pritchard battle on the timer's table. Johnny Rich hooks the sleeper now.
20 minutes.
Davey moves in and nails Jim Cornette.
Tom Pritchard going into his trucks for a foreign object. He's going to come up with it. Referee's back is turned. Let's see what happens.
Spotlight kick with whatever it is he has put on the toe of his boot. He slides back out, pulls it off. And the winners are the heavenly bodies. They defend
title.
Your winner and still champion, Johnny Rich. The Smoky Mountain Tag Team Championship.
It was not a clear cut victory.
No, it was not a pretty win either, because when Pitcher put his foreign object on his boot, that was all she wrote for the party before.
The Heavenly Bodies defend their Smoky Mountain Tag Team Championships against the
Pitcher,
Johnny and Davey. And right now, we're going back to the dressing room to hear from the champions.
Okay, fans, I'm standing here with the greatest tag team in professional wrestling, the Heavenly Bodies. You've just dusted the Party Patrol. Stan, what are your comments tonight?
You know something, Dutch Mantell? I've heard all of my life that it's lonely at the top. But you know something? That's a bald-faced lie. It's great at the top. We knew how good we were. There was no doubt, never, ever any doubt in our minds that we're the greatest thing in professional sports today. We are the Heavenly Bodies. We're the Smoky Mountain Tag Team Champions, and we will remain the Smoky Mountain Tag Team Champions for as long as we deem fit. Right, Doctor?
You know, Dutch, Stan, Jim, it all seemed to come that everybody said, what can you do in Knoxville? When it comes right down to it, what can you do in the Smoky Mountain Tournament that hasn't already been done? Well, you see, we already beat the Fantastics. We didn't even have to go through any kind of tournament here in Knoxville. We went right to the Party Patrol. We put the Fantastics out of the picture. You got guys like the Batten Twins. You got every other kind of tag team that wants to come and make a bid for these belts. Well, you see, the fact of the matter is, we are the greatest tag team
yes,
in Smoky Mountain Wrestling.
Yes, you are.
And we're going to stay yes. the greatest yes. tag team in Smoky Mountain Wrestling.
And let me talk right now to the greatest manager in the sport, not today, but of all time, Jim Cornette. Jim, your comments?
I don't know why anybody thought any different. When was the last time I was associated with something that wasn't a success?
Right.
When was the last time Stan Lane was associated with something that wasn't a success?
Right.
Tom Pritchard associated with something that wasn't a success.
Right.
It don't happen very often because we're the greatest at what we do. Johnny and Davey Rich, you're just another example. All these rednecks here in East Tennessee, all the rednecks and the hillbillies all over the Smoky Mountain wrestling area, they're going to have to learn to deal with us. Your women want these guys so bad, they don't know what to do because it's the first time in their lives they've seen real men.
That's right.
And at the same time, you look at me and you say, Jim Cornette, you got all that money. You're sitting on top of the world. We, meanwhile, are failures. We're handing out food stamps at the grocery store because we can't support our family. We got no direction in life. That ain't my problem. We're on top of the world. We got the gold. They got the women. I got the money. And we do what we want to do. Johnny and Davey Rich, you want another shot? Come on. You're more than welcome. Because I'll guarantee you one thing, brother. I'll look you straight in the eye. And I'll tell you this. Riches, Battens and the Fantastics, if they got the guts to come back, we ain't playing. This ain't cartoon wrestling here. If you want to get something, you got to fight for it. And brother, we're the ones doing it in Smoky Mountain Wrestling. We're fighting and we're winning. And if anybody in the ring or outside the ring thinks they can take these men, brother, and thinks they can get to me, I got news for you. You better wake up and apologize because you're having a real sorry dream.
Ladies and gentlemen, I just left primetime Brian Lee with the medics. He lost a lot of blood and he's got a possible shoulder injury. So, considering all that, I don't think I have any choice because the medics have advised him not to wrestle again because of the loss of blood and the shoulder injury. It's the award, Mr. Wonderful Paul Arnold and the champion.
Commissioner Bob Armstrong has awarded the belt to Paul Orndorff. They have asked Brian Lee not to wrestle. He was with the medics.
Wait a minute.
Wait a minute.
Orndorff has the belt, but here comes primetime Brian Lee back to the ring. Can Bob reclaim the belt?
Paul Orndorff,
as long as Brian.
Knoxville, Tennessee. I've come too far to let some doctor tell me I can't win that belt. And Paul, if you want that belt, you will have to go through me.
Well, Orndorff has the belt.
So your final is on, and what a barn burner it's going to be. Primetime, Brian Lee, Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff, going at it hammer and tongs, Phil, for the Smoky Mountain Heavyweight Wrestling Championship.
Well, just a moment ago, Commissioner Bob Armstrong awarded Paul Orndorff the belt, but Brian Lee is back out here now, and he's not going to let it go that easily.
They had asked Brian not to wrestle. Brian told Orndorff, if you want this belt, you're going to have to go through me. I've come too far. And Brian's showing right now why they call him Prime Time. Orndorff gets the leg up and slows Lee down. Catches him with a short clothesline. Goes up to the second strand. Drops that elbow onto that forehead. And as he went after Robert Gibson's knee in the semifinal, he'll be going after that head in this one, Phil.
Still a lot of blood pouring from the head of Primetime Brian Lee.
Brian Lee down on the floor now.
He's looking for a chair. And we saw this earlier.
Orndorff drives a chair into the head of Brian Lee. And now sends Lee crashing into the table at ringside.
Well, one thing about it, our announcing vantage point here at this volunteer slam has taken a lot of punishment.
Retaliation by Brian Lee staggers Orndorff. Both men dazed now. Back and forth, back and forth. Both men punching away. Orndorff pitched back in the ring as Lee follows him through the ropes.
Here's Primetime Brian Lee driving a fist into the head of Paul Orndorff.
Suplex by Brian Lee dropped Mr. Wonderful. And hey, bad shoulder, laceration. I don't know. I'm not counting this kid out.
No, as you pointed out at the top of the show, he has a lot of heart and a lot of will and a lot of determination. And he has proven time and time again as he's come back in the three matches he's worked in this tournament that he is a competitor.
He certainly is. He's a gamer, as they say. But Orndorff right now trying to put this one away. He had that belt in his hands only to have Brian Lee come from the dressing room and say, hey, I earned this match, and you're going to have to beat me to go home with that belt. And he's sure proven that he is one of the top pros in the country.
Primetime Brian Lee driving Orndorff's head into that top turnbuckle. Six, seven, seven, eight possibly times he crashed his head into the turnbuckle. Now he has the headlock.
Short suplex, though, by Orndorff. A last-ditch effort on Orndorff's part. Lee trying to cinch down that headlock before he could establish it. Orndorff was able to bail him back into that short suplex. Brian kicks out. Orndorff's been slowed now, Phil. And, of course, this is match number three for both these guys. So not only the injury, not only the cut, but the fact Orndorff's been worn down pretty bad, too.
This has not been an easy way to this championship match for either wrestler.
But Brian Lee's right back in there. He's nailing Orndorff, and Orndorff hits the deck. Brian Lee has taken over offensively, and he wants that Smoky Mountain heavyweight belt.
Orndorff catching a lot out of right field there.
Lee sets him up, sends him cross ring into the turnbuckle, follows him in with a kick to the midsection. Now, let's hope Brian doesn't get too careless here. Orndorff reverses it on him, though. But the clothesline comes from Lee. And both men are down, and both men stunned. Referee starts the count, and it's on both wrestlers at this point. Phil, what do you think? If they were both to be counted out, we come back again with another title match.
I don't know if that's going to happen, Les. I think one of these guys, the strong will survive in this match.
Orndorff trying to set Lee up as he shorted him off, cut him with a short push off to the ropes. But as he came back, Paul couldn't get quite straightened up. Both men collided, obviously knocking heads, and they're both down and again dazed. And although it is Lee who is bleeding, Orndorff has been worn down, and he's dazed as well. What? Orndorff blocked, two quick right hands. And an elbow as he drew back, hits the referee, and down he goes. Phil, we've got no official.
And Commissioner Bob Armstrong makes his way to the ring. He is going to try to get the official, Mark Curtis, on his feet as he rolls him over. In the meantime,
he's asked Rex Hargrove to come help get the referee out. Orndorff trying for the pile driver. Lee reverses it, backdrops him.
And the referee is still out ringside being administered by Armstrong.
Commissioner. White boy, and he gets clubbed.
Foreign object thrown into the ring, and Orndorff has it.
He threw something to Orndorff. And Brian Lee ducks the onslaught. Nails him. Both men down. The referee is still out. We have mass confusion. Dirty White Boys on the floor outside the ring. Orndorff, whatever he had in his hand, has dropped it, Phil.
And he covers Brian Lee, gets a two count. Oh, Armstrong has taken over the referee's job. Two count by Commissioner Bob Armstrong.
So I'm assuming you're right now that Bob will finish off refereeing the match.
Again, Orndorff has that object on his wrist, on his fist now as he sets him up.
Lee coming to his feet, and again, Brian blocks it. He's got it. Let's see what happens. Armstrong has got it. Commissioner turned referee for the remainder of this match has got it.
And he just
calls for the bell. It is a disqualification. And Brian Lee is the heavyweight champion for Smoky Mountain Wrestling. Look here. Dirty White Boys coming in. They're both after him now. Armstrong.
Armstrong has taken the foreign object away from Paul Orndorff. They're down in the ring.
They're calling out the troops. We got wrestlers all over the place.
And total pandemonium reigns as the crowd
erupts. He should put the tights back on. We've got a free-for-all, although Brian Lee is your Smoky Mountain Heavyweight Wrestling Champion. By virtue of a disqualification, Bob Armstrong picking up as the referee. Wrestlers filling the ring. The match is over. Brian Lee is your champion, Phil. It's been a great, great tournament.
Yep. Okay, fans, what a tremendous title match. I'm waiting for Paul Orndorff to come in here right now to talk to us about the match with Brian.
Dutch, that was a Smoky Mountain ripoff. That's exactly what it was.
Absolutely.
You know something, Brian Lee? You put up a pretty good fight. But so did Saddam Hussein. You see all this blood? It ain't my blood, brother. You bled all over that ring. They saw more blood in Knoxville than they did in the war. But I'm going to tell you this right now. When Mr. Wonderful steps in the ring, I've showed everybody here. Bob Armstrong, there's been a conspiracy against me ever since I came into this place. And I'm going to tell you, it goes back a long way. But it doesn't matter to me. Anywhere you want to finish this thing, what's his name again? Brian Lee, Brian, sweet man. Thing, bleeding all over the place out there. I'm going to tell you something right now, man. This is hell looking you right in the face, and I don't care where it's at in Tennessee. You name the place, Bob Armstrong, you come to the match, because the next time you stick your nose in a match, I'm going to pile drive you, Brian Lee, and every dead gum body that's associated with this Smoky Mountain Wrestling. I'm sick and tired of it. You know what I can do and what I've done to everybody I've stepped in the ring with there. So you just wait. It's coming down soon, brother. Mr. Wonderful's got one thing on his mind, and it ain't money, it's that belt.
I couldn't have said it any better myself.
Ladies and gentlemen, here we are with the new Smoky Mountain Heavyweight Champion, Primetime Brian Lee. Brian?
You know, this should be the happiest day of my life, but it isn't. And it's two reasons why it isn't. Dirty White Boys won, and Mr. Wonderful's number two. I'll tell you what, you boys underestimated me, but now it's time to pay the fiddler. Dirty White Boy, Mr. Wonderful, I don't care what it takes, where I have to go. You see my head? I won't stop till every inch of your body is covered just like my head. You can look out for Primetime Brian Lee, because I'm through playing around.